MedCram.
Thank you for joining me for part two of medical acid base. Kind of to review what we were talking about before, we were talking about the Henderson-Hasselbalch, which I'll go ahead and write for you here. In terms of what that was, it was the pH is equal to the 6.1 plus the log of this big equation, the concentration of HCO3 minus over the PCO2 times 0.03. And we just got finished saying that we talked about the two issues. Here are the two variables in the equation. One was the bicarbonate, which was primarily dealing with metabolic processes, and the other one was the PCO2. And we said that if the bicarb was changed, that was a metabolic process, and if the PCO2 was changed, that was a respiratory process. If the bicarb went down, that was a metabolic acidosis. If the bicarb went up, it was a metabolic alkalosis. If the PCO2 were to go down, that would be a respiratory alkalosis. And if the PCO2 were to go up, it would be a respiratory acidosis. So respiratory here on the CO2, metabolic on the bicarb. And if all those things change, then that would be an acidemia or an alkalemia. So I kind of want to split this up here into two categories, the HCO3 minus and the PCO2. And I kind of want to just tell you the differences between these two. As we talked about, the bicarb is primarily made in the kidney, okay? Where and it can be excreted in the kidney and change and all that sort of stuff, whereas the PCO2 is primarily a lung situation. So bicarb can have processes happening all over the body and many different processes occurring all at once. You can have several different metabolic acidosis. For instance, diarrhea can cause a metabolic acidosis, and vomiting can cause a metabolic alkalosis, and both of them can be occurring at the same time. Ironically, they would cross-cancel at each other, interestingly, but both metabolic acidoses and alkalosis, both metabolic problems. So you can have multiple happening at the same time, whereas you only have one lung, and it can either breathe only either fast or slow. So there's a single. You can't have a respiratory acidosis and a respiratory alkalosis at the same time. As I mentioned, your lungs can only breathe fast or slow. So this can only happen once. This, in terms of the kidney modifying bicarbonate, takes a long time. So like days for that to happen. Whereas the lung can start to breathe quickly or slowly almost immediately. So this is like minutes in terms of how fast things can happen. So there are definitely differences here between bicarbonate. It's a metabolic situation, it's kidney, multiple can happen at the same time, and it takes days for the kidney to ramp up or to change when we talk about compensation. PCO2, on the other hand, primarily is governed by the lung. There's only one lung. Well, there's actually two, but there's only one organ. It can only breathe so fast, either fast or slow. And that change can happen in minutes. I want to explore a little bit about bicarb, because bicarb is kind of an unusual situation here. So let's go ahead and put it up here. So HCO3 minus. Okay, so there's kind of two ways in which you can lose bicarb, or bicarb can go down, and that would be a metabolic acidosis. You can lose it because you're combining with a proton, okay? And in which case, you'll lose it because, remember, we talked about bicarbonate plus a proton will turn into carbonic acid. Carbonic acid will then turn into a water molecule and a CO2 molecule, which you'll breathe off. And so bicarb can go down because you're combining with a proton, and you'll lose the bicarb molecule that way. Or the other way you can lose bicarb is just simply loss. You just lose the bicarb. So you lose it because you pee it out, or you lose it because you poop it out. And so those are two different ways. Now, let's talk about those two different ways of looking at this. So if you lose bicarb from simply just losing bicarb, your bicarb will start to fall. But what will happen is you're actually losing negative charges. Okay. So what will happen is your chloride, or your measured chloride, will will go up in that situation. And why is that important? Well, it's important because all of the positive charges in your body and all of the negative charges in your body have to remain the same. And maybe I can demonstrate here by drawing a Chem 7. Okay? You'll see this over and over again in medicine, where we have the sodium, we have the potassium, chloride. This says CO2, but really it's the bicarb. Okay. This is the blood urea nitrogen, this is the creatinine, and this is glucose. So I want you to notice this, because this will become important later, is that the positive charges are in the first column, and the negative charges are in the second column. Now, why is this important? Well, we'll talk about this. Obviously, the body has as many positive charges in it as it does negative charges. If you didn't, then you would be statically electrically charged, and the body can't have that. So there are equal number of positive charges as there are negative charges. But the problem with our little Chem 7, as we call it here, is that we're not accounting for all of the positive charges. There's calcium that we don't have here. There is magnesium that we don't have here. And likewise, we don't have all the negative charges here. We don't have phosphorus and sulfates and all sorts of things that are negatively charged. But we've got negatively charged chloride, and we've got negatively charged bicarbonate over here. So if we were to add up in a normal situation, the sodium, which is usually about 140, and the potassium, which is around 4, and the chloride, which is, you know, around 100 or so, and then the CO2, which is around 24, you can see very closely and very clearly here that your positive charges are going to outnumber your negative charges. And when that happens, that's a normal situation. And in fact, when we calculate this, we don't even use the potassium in that calculation. So what we've come up here is with something called the anion gap. Now, the anion gap is simply an artificial measurement. It's artificial because we've chosen to include these electrolytes in this Chem 7, and what we've done is we've chosen to take the chloride and the CO2 and subtract it from the sodium. And the normal anion gap is, in a normal person, 12. So that means that if we take the sodium and we subtract out the total negative charges, which is the chloride and the CO2, we will get an anion gap of 12. What does that mean? That means there are 12 negatively charged units out there floating around in the body that we're not accounting for in our Chem 7. And that's normal. That's okay. So what does that mean? That simply means that we can tell if there are other negative particles that somehow come up all of a sudden. And so what happens? Well, let's go back to our bicarbonate thing again. Remember, bicarbonate, there's two different ways of losing bicarbonate. One of the ways is if it combines with a positively charged proton. Where is that proton going to be coming from? Well, as you recall from chemistry, whenever there's an acid, okay, there's always a proton and a conjugate base. And then when that proton comes off, the conjugate base becomes negatively charged, and the proton comes off, and in this case, it's going to combine with the bicarb to make CO2 and H2O. The key here, however, is that now we have a negatively charged particle that is now floating around in the body. So what is that going to do to our anion gap? It's going to increase it. And so your anion gap will increase whenever you have a situation where bicarb is lost because it combined with a proton that was attached to a conjugate base. Now, what is that conjugate base? What could it be? It could be anything. It can be anything, any negatively charged particle that's not either a chloride or a bicarbonate. And that's important to know because there are certain medical conditions where you have these anion gaps that occur that tells you that's how the bicarb was lost. Okay, so let's talk a little bit more about the anion gap. We said before that the anion gap is usually What does that mean? Well, what makes up the majority of that anion gap? As it turns out, the molecule or protein albumin makes up the majority of that anion gap, which is 12. What's the body's normal composition of albumin? How much albumin is there normally in the body? Well, if you were to measure in terms of milligrams per deciliter, it would be 4. So 4 causes you to have an anion gap of about 12. That's a good way to calculate what the normal anion gap should be for somebody, because let's say somebody had an albumin of 2. Then what would their normal anion gap be? You can see that it would be about 6. That's important to know, because if you know what somebody's predicted anion gap is, you'll be able to tell whether or not there's an anion gap metabolic acidosis or something occurring. Because if somebody has a process that is eating up bicarbonate because there is an acid that's giving off a protein, and that bicarb is being lost because it's combining with a protein that was on a conjugate base, as we showed in the last slide, that's going to increase your anion gap. So if for instance, somebody has an anion gap of 20, because we just calculated the anion gap, and remember what the anion gap is. The anion gap is simply the sodium minus the addition of the chloride plus the bicarb. That will equal the anion gap. Okay, and if it is 20, then we know that's higher than what it should normally be. It should normally be about 12. Okay, if someone has an albumin of 4. That means that there's 8 units. There's an 8-unit jump. That means there's 8 units of conjugate base floating around that shouldn't have been there. And it's causing an acidosis, a metabolic acidosis. However, if we calculate an anion gap and it's 20, and our albumin is only 2, that would mean our anion gap should be only about 6. And therefore, the difference between these two is actually 14, which means that there are 14 units of anion gap that's floating around that shouldn't be there. Okay, so let's review again. Let's go back and talk about bicarbonate. We said already that there's two ways that you can lose bicarbonate. One is simply just loss of bicarbonate. And the other one is combining with a proton that comes from a conjugate base. If that happens, you'll be left with a conjugate base that's negatively charged. We can't keep track of that negatively charged molecule in the Chem7 because it's not a chloride and bicarbonate. Therefore, there's going to be an increase in something called the anion gap. The anion gap is calculated by simply the equation of the sodium minus the chloride plus the CO2, or the bicarb, HCO3 minus. So if you take the sodium and you subtract the addition of the chloride plus the bicarb, you'll get the anion gap, the actual anion gap. That actual anion gap, if it's greater than what you would predict the anion gap to be. And what is the predicted anion gap? The predicted anion gap should be the albumin times 3. Normal albumin is 4, so 4 times 3 is 12. This, whenever you get an increased anion gap, this is termed an anion gap metabolic acidosis. It's possible for you to just lose bicarbonate through loss and not cause that. In that situation, when you lose bicarbonate, you will not be causing an anion gap. And this is important because you'll be able to tell the difference between an anion gap metabolic acidosis and a non-anion gap metabolic acidosis. So now we'll get into a little bit more about the acid-base disturbances and how to calculate them and what's compensation in our next part, part 3. Thanks for joining.